Today on Matters of Fact, part of the reason for the good conduct time allowance law was to decongest Philippine jails. A commission and audit report put the congestion level at nearly 430% in 2018, which was actually a big improvement from the year before. Now a senator wants the private sector to come in and help improve conditions in the country's correctional facilities. Joining us from our Rockwell studio is Senator Francis Tolentino. Good morning, Senator, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Good morning to your viewers as well.
Okay, let's start with this proposal of yours to privatize Philippine prisons. What exactly are we talking about here?
I'm referring to a situation. It's just part of a clear menu of public policy options of putting in place a private sector initiative that would help decongest our jails. But it has something to do with offenses which are not violent in nature. I'm referring to offenses punishable by prison, correctional, and below. Those below 6 years imprisonment to help decongest our jails would be placed in private jail facilities. And this has been done in other countries, New Zealand, Australia, the United States, even Thailand, which is part of the ASEAN. So all those prisoners convicted of heinous crimes will be placed in Bucor managed facilities, but those of lesser offenses, convicted of lesser offenses, would be in semi-private facilities.
Will this also apply in the case of jail facilities run by provincial governments?
It can be done. It can segue to that if needed, but generally, my proposal, and this was it came out during my interpellation, was really to, one, to save on expense, two, to produce a more efficient jail management system, and number three, to enable those convicted of lesser offenses to be reintegrated back to the society's the mainstream society after they have served their prison term. But it's not really being soft on crime. I'm tough on crime. I'm for death penalty, by the way. But just to separate the heinous crime offenders with the non-heinous crime violators.
So based on your idea, the heinous crime convicts will be kept still in a jail facilities run by the state.
Correct.
So, for example, we're talking here of the new Bilibid prison. So those who are convicted of heinous crimes will still be in the NBP, and the NBP would still be run by the government.
Correct. But it can, for those of lesser non-violent offenses, for example, use of fictitious names, offenses punishable by prison, correctional, and below, 6 years and below, can be given to private institution. And this is not new to the Philippines. We have for instance, before drug facilities, rehabilitation facilities run by the government. Now we have a proliferation of drug rehabilitation centers run by the private sector. So what I'm trying to drive at is the money, the value of peso invested by the government can be spread out and producing economic scale and perhaps more efficiently run a prison facility for non-heinous crime offenders, convicts.
Now, when you talk about privatization, are you also referring to what different facets of the jail management system? For example, are we talking about construction,
yes,
or management of facilities,
yes,
or everything?
It can be a variety, a hybrid of options. For instance, non-sovereign functions. For instance, the maintenance of the landscape, the engineering aspect, the nutritional aspect, the kitchen facilities, the laundry facilities, that can be privatized. You can have, for instance, a model similar to France, wherein the government will construct, the private sector will manage, but the security aspect will be still government. You can have another model wherein the private sector will construct, but the government will manage the security aspect. And you can have a hybrid both similar to your PPP, private public partnership, wherein it's both the private and the government constructing the jail facilities, because the expense involved in constructing a new facility, especially if it's a maximum or supermax facility, would entail a huge chunk of our budget.
Now, which model do you think would suit the Philippine situation best?
I would opt for the French or the New Zealand model. Incidentally, Thailand is doing this, Japan is doing this, wherein a facility would be for lesser offenses would be for non-violent convicts would be run, the non-sovereign aspects would be run by the private sector, but the management of the security would still be under the auspices of Bucor.
Now, of course, one concern here is the standard. So how do you make sure that there will be a good standard that will be applied to all jail facilities, even those that are constructed perhaps, or perhaps even run by the private sector?
I think there has got to be an international standard to be followed. You're correct. It's still going to be supervised by the government, so the international standards would have to be followed. You have to have the CCTV, you have to have the medical facilities, you have to have the strict implementation of the UN standards for persons deprived of liberty, etc., etc. So the government will still be there, but savings in terms of the success stories that I've read, savings will be there because the government will be able to save a huge amount of money in terms of the salaries, the health insurance of the government personnel that are part of the present Bucor setup, retirement benefits of the Bucor, etc. So, but I'm not saying that this is the silver bullet. There are also failures, they reverted back to the public model. So, but what I have said is that this has to be part of the menu of public policy options that we have to consider if we are really serious in reforming our penal system.
Because I think one of the questions that also need to be asked is that does the Philippine government actually does not have enough budget for this improvement in the jail facilities, or is it a case that is it a matter of not putting much priority in this particular problem or area?
I've looked at the budget, the budget for 2020 of the of the Department of Justice. Almost 19% of the budget for next year will be given to the Bureau of Correction. So it's not just the availability of budget, but the prioritizing. So to speak, do we invest more for less serious offenders, or do we spend more for the education of the youth? For instance, I've seen studies wherein if the government spends more for early preschool education of the youth, 4 years old, 5 years old, there are studies that would show that those who are given good pre-kindergarten educational support would in the long term be less involved in street offenses or be involved in drugs. But these are studies. So it's a matter of balancing priorities. So that's why you need the support likewise of the private sector. But just the same, we have to be very strict. We have to be very tough on heinous crimes. I have said this several times that I'm even in favor of the death penalty. But for less serious crime offenders, there has to be a pathway for them to be given a chance to be reintegrated to mainstream society, be a productive citizen. But for the heinous crime violators, offenders, drug crime violators, they have to pay their due to society.
And of course, assuming that this proposal of yours happens, the government can focus a good part of its resources to improving the jail facilities for those heinous crime convicts as well, I suppose.
Correct, because records show that I have the report coming from the Supreme Court that we the Court of Appeals solved more than 3,000 heinous crime offenses crimes on appeal, and then this would again add up to a greater number of prisoners entering the new Bilibid prisons for this year. So you will add up to the more than 33,000 heinous crime offenders within the Bucor facility. So again, you put more pressure not just in a congested jail facility, but you put more pressure in the system itself, given the limited budget, given the limited facilities and structure. So again, it's not conducive to what the law intends to achieve.
Now let's go to the issue of oversight on the part of the government, because if you put the private sector in the equation, so how do you make sure that there's enough government oversight that would prevent possible abuses? For example, we have this problem at the new Bilibid prisons where moneyed inmates came up with their own COBOL or their own jail facilities, quote unquote, within the new Bilibid prison. How do you prevent these things from happening the moment that you put the private sector in the equation?
If you're referring to the heinous crime offenders, I think there will be decongestion, because the bulk are non-serious, non-heinous crime offenders. So the COBOLs there would be easily, for the heinous crimes, they can easily be cleared, because probably, I don't know the exact reasons, probably the grant of a the grant of some privileges has something to do also with the lack of appropriate, adequate space within the facility. So I don't see any reason why it would be allowed in the private sector run facilities, because the two institutions will be looking at each other, the government side and the private sector watching each other's back. So I suppose for purposes of transparency, the hybrid system can work for less serious crimes.
Now, on the part of the private sector, what's in it for them? Will this be good investment for a private firm to, let's say, put up a jail facility using its own investments?
Good question. I've seen reports that in the United States, for instance, even banks, they put up funds to support this, Wells Fargo, General Electric, to name a few, because of the profit side. But again, if you look at the negative aspect of this, probably is it good for a private institution to be involved when their aim is for profit, or is it better to have a non-profit private institution be in charge of this? So these are the aspects to be balanced. But again, what I propose is to add up an ingredient to the menu of public policy options that our government can study. But this is not, again, a silver bullet solution. I'm just putting up several other alternatives that can be seen by the legislature and the executive eventually.
Yeah, fair enough. But again, if I am a private sector investor, what's in it for me? What's the come on for me to enter into this engagement?
There are several models. There are several corporations right now. One is called CORE. Involved in this. It's an international institution. What's in it for them? There's a profit side for them, being able to run a private facility. Just as I mentioned a while ago, even Wells Fargo Bank invested heavily, and their shares went up after investing in private jail facilities. So it's probably being able to serve society is probably also part of their revenue generating motive, among other things.
Okay, now Senator Tolentino, I'll also take this advantage because you are a former MMDA chairman. We know the traffic situation in Metro Manila, and recently the situation was described by one group as a traffic crisis already. Now, we know in the last hearing in the Senate, there was a report that the DOTR was no longer interested in seeking emergency powers for President Rodrigo Duterte. But of course, I know that you have a pending proposal to grant the president emergency powers. Now, is this a good idea to no longer seek emergency powers for the president to address the traffic problem in Metro Manila, for example? Senator Tolentino?
Yes, I in fact, during the budget hearing of the DOTR, I was the one who asked Secretary Tugade wherein I asked him whether they're still interested in having the emergency powers pushed, and he answered in the negative. But after a few minutes, coincidentally, the LRT depot in Santolan was gutted by a fire, which resulted in the destruction of the rectifier facility. So it just goes to show that there are probably some other aspects wherein an emergency power would be needed. That instance would need, I was informed, 9 to 12 months to be repaired, to have that facility repaired, and you imagine the traffic, the inconvenience that will be suffered by Marikina residents going to Santolan, Cubao, for instance. It will take time, but with the emergency power in place, I think the procurement law, Republic Act 9184, would not just sidetrack, but would help facilitate the purchase of whatever equipment would be needed to repair that LRT depot. Again, if Secretary Tugade, and he represents the executive branch, is not interested in the emergency powers, I think it's the option of the executive branch. But we just offered again the solution which was proposed in the 17th Congress. And if they have some other alternatives, so be it. The legislative branch would just be supportive of the DOTR.
But again, given the situation of the traffic now in Metro Manila, do you think the president still needs emergency powers to address the issues like you mentioned, for example, expediting the procurement process?
I think there are aspects that can be answered by the OTR. There are certain modes that can help alleviate the traffic problem. For instance, even without the emergency power, I just heard yesterday, as chairman of the Committee on Local Government, a bill which would allow local government units of highly urbanized areas to have their own mass transit facilities. I'm referring to Makati, which will groundbreak this month, a subway facility. I'm referring to to Manila's monorail from Roas Boulevard to Intramuros. So if we really want to put the pieces together, you'll have front-end and back-end solutions. I think a portion of the emergency power bill can still be applied.
Yeah, you mentioned those individual proposals coming from the different local governments, but of course, looking at them from a big picture perspective, you would still need some sort of organization to integrate them, because Metro Manila is not that big in terms of land area, given the huge population that we have in Metro Manila.
You're correct, but my proposal is that they will still have to adapt to the whatever national government or DOTR transport plan there is. But it will allow them, utilizing their own resources, without asking for sovereign guarantee, without asking for national government funding support, to put in place their own mass transit facility, similar to the New York Transit Authority. The New York State government maintains that, similar to the Tokyo Metropolitan Government subway and railways facilities. It's being run by the Tokyo Metropolitan Government. So what I'm saying is this: there probably might be some local solutions to our national problems. It's not just the prerogative and the monopoly of the national government to provide the solutions. The local government units, I believe, I came from the local government sector, can provide a some solutions, because they're more familiar with their own landscape, their own jurisdiction, so to speak.
I remember before the debate was regarding the details of which particular areas the DOTR would require emergency powers for the president, and I think later on the discussions focus on addressing infrastructure issues. Now, when it comes, for example, to congestion of vehicles along EDSA, for example, how do you think emergency powers could help address, for example, the problem with the too many bus franchises that have been granted over the years. Can this also help address those issues?
Yes. Again, it's the administrative turf of DOTR because they have within their bureau within their department, the LTFRB. It's the government agency in charge of issuing franchises. So this is beyond the LGU turf. So I have been proposing that the DOTR starts from zero, scratch. We need to review those given franchises, the need, the market demand, the availability of parking spaces, their terminals, among other things. So this is within the turf of DOTR, and to have them review that, I think the LGUs will not be part of the picture.
Okay, Senator Francis Tolentino, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, and good morning.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.